So there we go. I think we should be recording now. Perfect. All right. So yeah, we're going to go ahead and get started. And before we actually get introduced to our speakers, I wanted to introduce this video. And I'm sure some of you are probably quite familiar with this. So let's just go ahead and play it from there.
The Democrats in DC have been and want to, at a much higher level, abolish our beautiful and successful suburbs by placing far-left Washington bureaucrats in charge of local zoning decisions. They're absolutely determined to eliminate single-family zoning, destroy the value of houses and communities already built, just as they have in Minneapolis and other locations that you read about today. Your home will go down in value and crime rates will rapidly rise. Joe Biden and his bosses from the radical left want to significantly multiply what they're doing now. And what will be the end result is you will totally destroy the beautiful suburbs. Suburbia will be no longer as we know it. So they wanted to fund and abolish your police and law enforcement, while at the same time destroying our great suburbs. The suburb destruction will end with us. Next week, I will be discussing the AFFH rule. AFFH rule, a disaster. And our plans to protect the suburbs from being obliterated by Washington Democrats, by people on the far left that want to see the suburbs destroyed, that don't care. People have worked all their lives to get into a community and now they're going to watch it go to hell. It's not going to happen, not while I'm here.
Okay, so there's quite a bit happening there. I just wanted to offer this video just to sort of frame ourselves as we learn more about housing and how integral and how like interconnected it is with all of these different isms that we come across all the time, right? Especially with housing. This is playing again.
The Democrats in DC have
go to the next
been
slide,
and want to at a much
it will let me. Sorry. Okay. And this brings me to our speakers. So today we have Roderick Hall, and he is the Director of Organizing with Abundant Housing LA. And we also have Chase Engelhardt, who is the Climate Planning and Resilience Coordinator with Climate Resolve. Chase, would you like to speak a little bit on Trumpism with housing and how that relates to what we're going to be talking about today, and introduce yourselves at large?
Yeah, so thank you for the introduction. It's nice to see so many faces here tonight. Some of you I've already met. Some of you, this is our first time meeting, but nonetheless, I'm excited. As Sahar mentioned, I'm the organizing director for Abundant Housing LA. And we really wanted to start with that video to contextualize the work that we are doing. For a lot of folks, if you don't know, the state of California, due to that video, actually, we have our own state version of AFFH to ensure that despite what does or does not happen at the federal level, we continue to build very prosperous communities here, especially on the West Side. And that bill is connected to the housing element update that's currently happening, not only in the city of LA, but in all 88 cities in unincorporated LA County right now. And it has mandated that you actually have to affirmatively further for housing as a part of that analysis. So as we go through this journey tonight that Chase is in particular gonna take us through, as we go through this history, we want to understand not only the history that has happened, but how we are in a moment in our we're in a moment in time where we have to ask ourselves, how are we looking at addressing this legacy of redlining that you see behind me? So we're really excited. It is not just housing, actually. Chase obviously is in climate, so I'm gonna turn it over to him, because this legacy of redlining spans outside of just one particular lane of urban planning. It spans into all things. So I'll turn it over to Chase, who can kind of speak more to climate.
Yeah, thanks, Rod. For those that don't know me, I'm Chase Engelhardt. I use he, him pronouns, and I'm the Climate Planning and Resilience Coordinator at Climate Resolve. We have a wide variety of programming, specifically focused on LA. What we're really trying to do is center people in climate change, so we all understand how climate change is affecting us and what we can do to stop it, and empower ourselves by knowing what's happening here in Los Angeles, and centering our experience, but also being as intersectional about it as we can. As Rod mentioned, housing is climate, and climate is housing. Where we allow people to live, where we encourage people to live, the availability of affordable housing, all of these things affect how much we drive. They affect proximity to pollution and other issues. So really, these are all one and the same, and we'll definitely be exploring that.
Thank you both so much. So that actually is going to get us into our next piece, which is a story building exercise. So if you can, I'm just gonna give everyone a couple of minutes to either get their notes app up, or a pen or pencil with some paper. And we're gonna do a little bit of story building just to start us off, and so that we can really insert ourselves into the experience of, say, for example, youth experiencing homelessness, right? Right, so there are two questions, and you have the option of filling out either one or answering either one, or if you wanna do both, then go for it. And this is really just in context of, or just taking into consideration that people are coming from different parts in life, right? So just really answer whatever question you feel appeals to you or is relevant to where your standing is right now. So the first question is, due to a variety of factors, you are now unhoused with little access to resources or connections. Where do you go? What do you do? And who do you get in contact with? And so there's some considerations that I want you all to think about as you write in, or journal. How do you know this information, right? Like, how was this information given to you? How do you know this right now? What methods of transportation and communication are you utilizing? And how do you access them? And of course, where is the story happening? Are you on the West Side? Are you down in Long Beach? Are you in the San Fernando Valley? And then lastly, what's your background? And now that's a very broad question on purpose, but I feel like that's gonna hopefully connect to all of the other questions that, or the other considerations.
How do I get rid of this?
Right, so the next question that you can also ask yourself is, if you could choose any place to be your home, where would it be? Feel free to choose anywhere in the world, even if it's somewhere you haven't been. Why did you choose this place, and why aren't you there now? Alternatively, if you're already there, what brought you there, and how were you able to move there? Rod, if you don't mind actually starting up some music, I'm gonna give everybody about 7 minutes, and then we'll just take it from there and have some share outs after that, okay?
Perfect. Can you hear me? I had to switch things to play the music. Okay, perfect. I'll start now. And just for context, so folks know, I created an Urban Planners playlist for Black History Month that kind of takes a variety of Black artists who chronicle their experience growing up in redlined communities to, put that in an art form. So I'm going to drop the links and resources to all of that. And the playlist you're hearing is from those folks who've experienced what we're going to talk about tonight.
Next level, we raise like the steel. They play too deep for the big hill. Wanna concentrate, hard to see still. Bird ain't coming in place in the top 10. You hear these hipsters dropping. You hear them down, cap. They say consciousness get in the game, rugged and play, get beat with edge. I'm eating something, niggas don't get discovered. They acting like you want some. Call me out of holy mind. Fuck your beat, just wait. Early in the morning, but I hate you with my show. Chief, yeah, nigga, your nose ain't funny. Perfect storm and the coast is flooded. Most discovered, I'm a flow, got a movie. Pose a sound like you're overstudy. Man, I'm more fast with you. I'm good, walk with you every day around the world. I'm pulling off integration with you. Found the word. I say the shit they relate to. Once you come down to earth, stop the rap and sound like they hate. Them niggas sound absurd. So when they walk to the ghetto, they get the chains now. They gotta talk to the ghetto to get the chains now. It's like an open-air prison and it remain packed. Nothing but straight facts. And they vibe for the people. By the people. Yeah, yeah, giddy up. We got the juice now. Snatch it out the kitty's cup. This shit you gave is watered down. This one's a Basquiat. Then he brushed with death, huh? Is this the auto of a cop? We double dutch and duck and shot. Every homie got a pop. Every man ain't selling rocks. A different will to win here. Different from switching cars. They pray that we switch our balls. It's a man of a metaphor. World star, world stars. Out of love in this life hard. Keep on praying like, oh God. Illegally thievery, niggas stealing off easily. Frustrated, we hate it, yeah. That's why we string up, nigga, we made it. Like the eye future, they ain't know we was awesome creators. Something from nothing was told to grow a man in front. For the people and by the people, but them over money. I'm on the value data share, working for justice. How you get away with murder and talking to people. How we supposed to not catch feelings, and it's alive, but we got keys in these buildings. I'm on my vows and days, what you call it, defense, all the drama they gave us, and shine around with, hot for you like ganja, that's what shine around with, all the back in the head, this shit, black in the bitch, real love just the Brooklyn way, this universe, 360 out of 9 lives, woo, what a show.
The song you just heard, just so folks know, was Every Ghetto by Talib, Ninth Wonder and Rhapsody. The next song is going to be Neighbors by J. Cole. It's a song chronicling the experiences of a Black man who moved into the suburbs and what that was like, despite experiencing economic mobility, still encountering racism.
Driveway, there's no rapper cars, just some shit to get from back and forth. Just
sponsorship to give it back and forth. Welcome to the show, this is pure. We'll help you if you felt insecure. To be the star you always knew you were. Wait, I think police is at
the door. Okay, neighbors think I'm selling dope.
All right, time is up. Thank you so much, Rod, for sharing that a bit of that amazing playlist. And so Rod actually linked it earlier in the chat. And so when I get a moment, I'll repost it for anybody that may have missed it. But let's go ahead and get started. Would anybody like to share their responses to either question? You can also utilize the chat, just by the way. Y'all, I can wait. Okay, in the chat we have social services, public library, right? Yeah, great. Accessing the public library, that makes a lot of sense. Absolutely. Local shelters in the metro, right? For sure. Okay, we have Emily naming the community, friends and family. Oh, and we also have a hand up. Michael, do you mind unmuting?
Right.
Hi.
Yeah, I was saying that I know if it happened immediately, you know, the mission downtown, I know I could go there and spend the night. And there are places where I am in Culver City, or I know if I had to, you know, if I couldn't find a bed, there are places I could sleep by the bike path. And you know, I would call Spy and say, I'm not a youth, but tell me where to go.
Right, for sure. I'm sure that's probably, and you know, a lot of folks are also naming that, right? Like nonprofit organizations who support the homeless, right? Like a lot of y'all are connected to these sorts of organizations. It's why everyone's here today, right? So like, that's also another piece of thinking about it, right? You know, how do you know that information? How do you have access to that information? You know, there are so many layers to that with access of information and like access to resources, right? And they include things like transportation. It's also a lot of class-related issues as well. But thanks, Michael, so much for sharing. Does anybody else want to share?
Tracy, I don't know if I can't find my raise my hand thingy, but I can definitely chime in. I've actually partially experienced homelessness in the Bay Area. And I think the Bay Area is a little bit easier to access resources because there is such a progressive way of looking at housing there. I mean, it's not perfect, but it's definitely more progressive than Los Angeles. I did agree with the library. I accessed family. I was fortunate enough to have family. Shelters for me isn't something I wanted to bring that up, is like to think about people who have experienced PTSD, mental health issues, where they've been put on a 5150 or anything like that. I think that those kinds of resources wouldn't be for them, and that's why I'm kind of here saying that, because like housing is so important. Like some people don't have that option because of their experiences, and they would go back into like a mental health state of feeling trapped. I also work for the Department of Rehabilitation, so I know that transportation is something that they cover. As long as you're searching for a job, they cover a stipend where they provide you transportation money or a voucher for a bus pass. So those are my things that I wanted to point out.
Right. No, thank you. And I think that your background is vital here, right? Like when we're talking, having these sorts of conversations, right? Like that, like what the barriers are, like what people are coming across. And I see a lot of folks sort of naming similar things in the chat, actually, right? Like, you know, talking about, okay, like, you know, if I wanted to call somebody, then like, you know, how would I even have access to like a power outlet, you know, and where would we even be able to find power outlets publicly, right? Where it's not socially stigmatized, right? Like, you know, there's a big difference like between going somewhere, you know, like to somewhere to find, I guess, like power, and then like, you know, maybe going to the Starbucks that's on Lincoln, right? You know, there's some certain stigmas that are attached to that. Right. And then there's, of course, solar chargers. Right. But of course, accessing solar chargers, that's how you would know that is by being connected to one of these service providers, sort of like SPY. Right. Any other share outs? So I think we can take one more before moving on.
I can share a little bit. I think what this question made me think about, too, is what are the variety of factors? You know, Chase here with climate, like if it's a earthquake or a major natural disaster, like what does my surroundings look like? Are those community resources even accessible? When you're talking about transportation, like so many different things can happen. Like is my first response was, okay, like family and friends. I would go to my family and friends, but are they okay? Like, what is the state of the variety of circumstances, because anything can happen at any point.
Exactly.
Yeah.
No, for sure. And that's like, and that's another piece as well, right? You know, that comes up a lot with SPY members, right? You know, sometimes that they just don't have anywhere to go because of class inequity, right? You know, like because like their families historically just don't have the resources to be able to support them. And that's something that SPY youth go through quite often. But everyone, thank you so much for sharing. But I'm really glad that we had this conversation, because again, like the Trump video and like this exercise, we're just trying to frame and, you know, so that when we get into this deeper discussion about maps and zoning, that we have that in the back of our minds and have that as our foundation. So as we gain this knowledge. But I'm going to go ahead and go to the next slide, and now handing it off completely to our speakers, Chase and Rod.
Thanks, Sahar. I just wanted to appreciate everybody's participation in that, and thank you to the people who shared their personal experiences and were vulnerable in this space. I really appreciate it. And as I go through this, I'm going to try and meld a little bit of storytelling with data. A lot of times we get bogged down in data, I mean, especially working in advocacy, and stories are really what move us. We need to understand what's happening, but we also need to understand where we fit into things. So I wanted to just preface this presentation with that thought. Redlining is something that happened in concert with a lot of other racist policies. In 1939, the Homeowners Loan Corporation produced a map of LA and really every major urban area, and I think some rural areas as well, in the United States, that divided neighborhoods into four categories. And that's what we're looking at in this map here, right? So we have, in green, we have desirable areas, and blue as well. And then these areas were generally majority white. And then there were declining or hazardous areas that were home to communities of color. And what these designations did were to decide whether or not loans for homes would be federally insured in these areas. And so what that allowed white folks to do at the time was to have preferential rates on their mortgage. Home ownership was much easier to come by. And if you were Black or another person of color, you wouldn't have access to a home loan, and you would be subject to either predatory loans or having to pay rent and not be able to establish yourself in a neighborhood. And as many folks I'm sure are familiar, home ownership is one of the largest engines of wealth in the United States. So it's an incredibly important piece, and it's very, very deeply tied to placemaking, right? So beyond just redlining and sort of using policy to not allow or inhibit the mobility of Black folks and other people of color, we also saw the destruction of communities for freeways. As we saw white flight and we saw white folks move out into the suburbs, so communities were torn down, which, you know, now we face climate emissions from that and poor air quality. And we also saw racial covenants, right? Culver City was a sundown town. And for those that are unfamiliar with the term, it was an implicit or sometimes explicit policy that cities had where gangs would terrorize Black folks in their town once the sun went down. So I wanted to give a broader picture of what this really means, and in terms of placemaking and the development and sort of the DNA of our neighborhoods. If we could go to the next slide. So we've done some overlays with these maps. Hopefully they're not too difficult to decipher. But we can see that part of redlining and covenants and other things, we have other tools that proliferate, right? So single family zoning was a tool that's been explicitly mentioned in rhetoric from planners back in the 40s, 50s, 60s as an alternative to racial segregation. Racial segregation was eventually ruled illegal. And single family zoning was a tool that helped support that. And we can see in Los Angeles in orange where that exists and how that overlays with these blue and green communities that were deemed desirable. Next slide. So looking more closely at pairs of neighborhoods, we can see the links between redlining and modern zoning, right? So looking at Los Feliz, Whitley Heights and Silver Lake that were defined as desirable continue to have heavily single family zoning, which can block new neighbors, right? And increase the cost of housing. And next slide. We see similar patterns in Central LA. I'll let people take a look at that, but I won't belabor it. Next slide. And then of course, the same patterns also exist here in West Los Angeles. So we'll take a look at that. Again, these orange parcels are single family zone parcels. And what that means is you are not allowed to build anything but a single family home on that parcel. So we'll go to the next slide now. So redlining and related zoning decisions continue to influence who can live where in LA. So census tracts with white majorities, which are in purple here, frequently overlap with the green and blue desirable areas on the Hulk map. So if we look at that, it's a pretty stark comparison, right? LA County is about 40. I haven't checked the latest statistic. I think it's 43% white. And these neighborhoods are all 60% or more white, which is a pretty stark contrast if we're looking at these. Next slide. And then, of course, if we're looking at census tracts with non-white majorities, which, you know, in LA, if we talk about the general population, is a majority non-white county, they tend to overlap with yellow, which were yellow or red areas, which are defined as declining or hazardous on this redlining map. Okay, and so we'll go to the next one. Oh, sorry. So I'm just reading the question. Zoning, we're seeing. So redlining started in, I believe, 1939 was the date. But throughout different periods, different decades in the United States, single family zoning was recognized as a tool as racial segregation became increasingly untenable as a political strategy. It was a tool used by urban planners to sort of uphold that segregation. So now census tracts. So similarly, you know, incomes is something that we see tied into this as well, right? So a lot of the rhetoric that we hear around affordable housing or permanent supportive housing can be tied in with wealth, right? There's an inherent level of classism and race that interplay in our country due to, you know, a litany of factors. And we can see that here in this map as well, right? With the green being areas that are higher income. If we can go to the next slide. And then, of course, we can see the lower median income households tend to overlap again with this is going to be pretty obvious trend, right, as we go through these slides with the yellow and redlined communities. So we go to the next slide. And so this is something that I wanted to bring up that we see an overlap not only with the actual placemaking, but what redlining made possible was environmental racism, right? So by making very intentional decisions geographically, the government was able to concentrate toxic sites and other sources of pollution in Black and Brown communities. And so what we see here is an overlay with something called the Cal EnviroScreen. And that's a tool that we use in California to determine environmental vulnerability, right? So exposure to different types of pollution. And it's, of course, also overlaid with different indices for health, race, and wealth, right? These are all things that affect our capacity to adapt. And so that's what we're seeing here as well, right? We're seeing higher environmental quality in these areas and higher concentrations of pollutions in redlined community. Next slide. And again, the converse, right? We see in redlined communities, much, much higher concentrations of pollution. So we'll go to the next slide. And then finally, you know, in the environment and public health are very intricately related. I think more than anything, 2020 was an opportunity for us to see that in terms of how pollution affected the mortality rate with COVID-19. And that's, you know, something that we see across the board with on a number of factors. So pre-existing conditions like diabetes or asthma can also affect the mortality rate when we have heat waves, right? When we have high levels of smog or when we have wildfires, right? So that's something that's going to affect people a lot more. If you can actually go to the next slide. So that is folks that are seeing better public health outcomes. And then of course, these are folks who are seeing worse public health outcomes. But to kind of put a human face to all of this, we're also seeing folks who are living in these communities who have to drive or take public transportation much farther, often to work in the communities that they can't afford to live in. There's no either affordable housing or any sort of housing typology that they can live in. And that affects people in a lot of ways, right? It affects our traffic and congestion. So that's going to be that's the largest source of our climate emissions, are the personal vehicle in the state of California. Industry, every smokestack that you see in the state of California is 25% of what we emit. 28% of our emissions are personal vehicles, just the cars that we drive. So it's the single largest source. So this is really driving climate change. And what that does is then creates this feedback loop of inequity, where you have day laborers who are working out in the Woolsey area during the Woolsey fire, who ended up walking down PCH because they had no route to leave from, right? They didn't have personal vehicles. You see people walking horses. And we actually have a report on this that you can find on our website that I'll link afterwards. But I think it's really important to, when we see these maps, to still think about people, right? We're seeing a lot of blotches and colors, which, you know, can be visually nice, but at the end of the day, these are people that we're talking about these outcomes affecting. So if we can go to the next slide. So with that, that's kind of the climate element of the placemaking and redlining that we've seen. And I'll hand it over to Rod to talk about housing specifically.
Thank you, Chase. Hey, y'all. So before I start this, there was a piece that we didn't do, and I was like, that we had kind of removed, but I'm like, you know, we should probably actually talk about that. So populations and demographics obviously shift in census tracts in your community. However, depending on your like level of nerdiness, how you define those, but demographics do shift. And a lot of these places that may have been redlined or yellowlined may not actually even be those populations that were once there, because we do in fact shift colored people around in this society. And so while this presentation doesn't get into this, I'm gonna drop the link to one of my favorite scholars, Andre Perry. He does an entire report. And if you haven't brought his book, you should also buy his book. Because a part of this isn't just about more homes, it's that we do not value Black people in this nation. His entire research dives deep into why Black communities, these red line, these yellow line communities, are worth less. Even when homes, and not just apartments, but single family homes owned by Black people compared to homes owned by white people, the homes are still worthless. And unfortunately, this past year, we saw a Black woman and a white man who were in a relationship. She took down all the pictures of the Black people in her house, and her home increased by $100,000 in value. So I just mentioned that because it's not just about housing. It is about how we don't value neighborhoods based on the color of the people in those neighborhoods, whether that's South Central or Bull Heights or East Hollywood, or some of the formerly, you know, areas on the West Side where we know that Black people were located but may not be located anymore. So I'll drop that link in there. It's really cool. Brookings is amazing. So they have an entire interactive dashboard that you can check out. You can read the report. And again, I strongly encourage you to buy the book as well. With that being said, I want to now dive into this distribution of affordable housing in LA. So of course, as everyone knows, Chase just took us through the history of redlining. It gets into zoning. We didn't cover that. There was a period actually in LA called the period of slow growth, where there was a lot of rapid down zoning happening, meaning the homes themselves remained, but the land under them and how they were zoned changed. So because of that, what we see a lot of is when we redline communities and we decided to create a nation based on the white middle class and the desires of the white middle class, that regulated white middle class people, and to a certain extent, poor whites, but not really, into a certain type of home. And then anyone who didn't fit that mold of white, middle class, you know, was regulated into, not necessarily, it wasn't that you couldn't buy a home, it's just it was added layers of difficulty. So the bulk of people obviously moved into apartments. What a lot of people don't know is why we now say R1 residential, R2, you know, R1 single family, R2 multifamily. It used to be in some places more explicit, and the R1 was specifically called white, and anything above that or, you know, higher density was called colored, to explicitly regulate where people could live. We know now that is not cool, per that Donald Trump video, to be outwardly racist. That does not mean the system we live in and the people who operate it will not continue to find other means to do so, which is what in a lot of ways zoning is, but more broadly, the evaluation of communities inherently is. So I share that to state, while redlining is not exactly happening nowadays, it has been set in our communities to continue to operate. So we're not necessarily barring people from moving where they want to. No one's saying explicitly, like, if you're a colored person, you can't move to the West Side, you can't move into some of these communities, you can't move into areas where there are, you know, better schools or the climate is better. But we know that the way race and class are deeply, deeply correlated and linked in our country, that there are going to be some limits of possibility. And in addition to that, because of this system that we've set, it has basically regulated where we build all homes for all people, regardless of whether you fit the historic molds or not, to certain areas of the city. So what you see here is the distribution of affordable housing. We don't have one for market rate housing, but it's probably going to look similar because of where we are legally allowed to build multifamily housing. And because of that, it has created this distribution where homes are only built on the areas where multifamily land is zoned. And of course, we know that that is only how it is because of redlining and this desire to keep certain people out of your neighborhood. And it's important to mention that because now we're at a point where transplants such as myself or Sahar or Chase, we're all transplants in our own ways. Even when we move into these communities, we also have to move into the red line areas. People who may be unhoused on the West Side, they may not be able to get housed because it may not be legally allowed to build homes there. And if you are a person who is involved with the unhoused advocacy, you know how important it is for any person, whether you're unhoused or not, to be housed near your community. And so all of these things add up and they create a hyper-competitive system for housing when you are only building housing in a finite amount of areas. And when those areas have historically always been built out, it begins to create these situations where we see demolitions or people maybe being treated wrongfully by their landlord or the property management company to clear the way for new homes. And while all of that is happening, we continue to see, to Chase's point, people not being able to live near the jobs that they have if they move into the city, and our unhoused neighbors who are on the West Side also not being able to be housed. Next slide, please. So, you know, going into that, this is the homelessness data for Los Angeles County. You can see here the portions of the West Side are highlighted, West Los Angeles County. You can see where existing supportive housing is located, and you can see where planned supportive housing is going to be located. And while it's great that we can build homes in these areas of the city where they are currently being built, those are not the only places where people need housing. And so again, you're basically regulating all people, unhoused people, transplants, long-term residents, anyone and everyone who basically didn't own a home by a certain point were being regulated into 25% of the residential land of the city. And again, that land is not inherently sitting empty. So it's not like we're building homes from the ground up. These lands, the land already has homes on them. It has commercial properties. It has parks and green space. It has communities who had to fight tooth and nail just to exist because, again, we created situations where that was not the case. And in addition to that, it creates hyper-competitive to the fact that when you are trying to have a piece of vacant land and you put out a request for proposal, you have people who may want to put a park there, but they're having to compete with people who need to have homes built. And if you're into parks like I am, you know that there's a certain level of service that parks are supposed to have in communities based on the amount of people present so that all people can have that green space. And we obviously saw how important green space has been over the past year as people were confined to their homes and needed to, at some points in time, get a little space to breathe. And so we don't really allow for the totality of healing to take place in redlined and yellowlined communities as long as communities that were greenlined or blueline continue to operate in their current iteration. Next slide, please. And we know this to be the case because we've seen with the 222 pledge put forth by everyone in, where every council district pledged to build 222 homes for our unhoused neighbors experiencing homelessness. And as you can see, Mike Bonin's district aside, shout out to District 11, Council District 11, all other white majority council districts failed to even meet this this goal. And when white communities fail to meet their goals, like everything else in the society, you put a disproportionate weight in labor on communities of color. As you can see here, CD1, CD14, CD13, even CD8, I mean, pretty much these are communities that not only went at 100%, but went way beyond 100% and went into 413%, 408%. And while I want to give props to those council members for ensuring homes get built, it is not equitable, nor has it ever been, to only have council districts of color, communities of color, individuals of color doing all of the work to save this planet and to address crises. We are all Angelenos and we all need to be doing our part if we are to get rid of this housing and homelessness crisis, get rid of the climate crisis, and so many more crises that have only been worsened due to COVID-19. And with that being said, if Sahar, if you could click on that Architect of Hope link put forth by someone who lives on the West Side, we're going to play this video that takes us, it's a promo video, but it's powerful nonetheless. And I think all people need to see it as we begin to dive deeper into who is unhoused.
Sorry, it's taking a minute to load.
My eviction began centuries ago with chains that in time hid themselves as rebar, stiffening the foundations, freeways, walls, ceilings, and doors which surround me, but offer only to shade the sidewalk where my laundry and television now wait, like fatherless children. Now I measure the darkness. I study each footstep or whisper. Where are you sleeping tonight, baby? My clothes sag and soil. My weight drops quickly, like your eyes as you rush past me, like my eyes as I remember rushing past another. Now I'm the one who's cold and alone, bleeding in the street. How do I root out these chains which still beneath immaculate backyards that push me away? How do I get off the street with blurred eyes and a pain in my neck? Show me how to build a home I can half afford. I want to warm. I move to mend. Help me find heart and hope to rise above pavement and stone. How do I shelter at home?
Thank you.
Next slide, please. So of course we, you know, we just really took y'all through a lot of history, a lot of facts. Thank you, Allison, for mentioning that over 50% of the youth, when I'm assuming you say we, SPY specifically, serve are Black. And, you know, as someone who moved from the South, the rural South at that, it is very, very, it's very embarrassing to hear how progressive the West Coast is and to see the treatment of Black people on the West Coast. They are not inherently matching up for me. That Black people make up such a small percentage of this county, but are way disproportionately overrepresented in the unhoused people while simultaneously being pushed out of the city altogether. It's a huge issue. And, you know, it's not anything of some natural markets that are just magically playing out. It is the result of, unfortunately, as it is, systemic racism. So with that being said, what I'm going to do, I'm going to actually quickly switch this image because it didn't load all the way. But as I'm doing that, folks are probably wondering after all of this, what can I do to get involved? So as we mentioned at the beginning of this call, the city is currently undergoing its housing element update process. And that's not just the city of LA, that is all 88 cities and unincorporated LA County as well. And the housing element, if folks are not familiar with it, is basically, someone just said this to me the other day and I love it, is that think of it as the housing constitution for your city. And if it is going to be the housing constitution for your city, thus it should be a constitution that is created by all Americans, unlike our original constitution. And it should be something that we all, and I shouldn't even frame it as all Americans, all residents of a city, whether you are a citizen or not, you live here, you should be partaking in the creation of this plan. And while this plan does not do the building of homes, it does set the direction for which we plan to build homes and where we plan to build them. If you don't know, the city of LA is currently has to, at a minimum, plan to build 456,000 homes by 2029. Santa Monica has its own version. Culver City has its own. Beverly Hills has its own. And as we plan to do that, we have to ask ourselves, are we going to continue to maintain the status quo and continue to operate in a way that bakes redlining and racism into our housing and built environment for the next decade? Or are we going to take steps to equitably distribute homes so that we are planning accordingly? I mean, when we say equitably distributing homes, we mean that making sure that every area in the city takes on an equitable amount. Equity being defined in this context as not only righting those wrongs, as we saw what council districts have been doing their part and what council districts have not, but also taking into account, again, AB 686 and the fact that we have to affirmatively further fair housing so that we can actually create better communities. I'm still looking for this as I talk, but that is kind of, you can go to the next slide, Sahar, and I'll just drop some stuff into the chat.
Rod, I sent it to you.
Oh, perfect. So that is everything. You know, we would love to have time for reflections and share outs. How has redlining affected you personally or people that you care about? If it hasn't, why do you think that may be? We have, in addition to that, some other questions. What parallels do you see? What are some of our shared experiences as Angelenos, as people on the West Side? And what do y'all think we need to be doing about this? I told you what I think based on the work I do for a living, but I'd also love to hear y'all's thoughts because this is something we all need to come together. Our nation was not a nation created with everyone. It was a nation created by property-owning white men and has slowly decided to encompass a lot more people over time, but never have we had the opportunity like we do now to come together as, again, Angelenos, as residents of Los Angeles County, together, not separately, to do something.
We have a hand raised with Luke. I'm going to unmute you.
Well, thank you. I firstly want to thank all of you for this and thank everyone for being here. I served for a couple of years as the president of my neighborhood council in Los Feliz. And we had a housing project that was proposed at the corner of Franklin and Western that was going to have, I think, 16 designated affordable units in it. And the redlining thing is really intensely personal here, because on one side of Franklin, it was yellow on the map, and on the other side, it was blue. And you might think, well, they're not that far apart, yellow and blue, but it is probably the most economically disparate location anywhere in central LA, where the median household income on the south side of Franklin today is $23,000. And the median income on the north side of Franklin across the street today is $156,000. And what we saw when we had this project that was proposed right at this corner was a bunch of folks who live in the community and on the one side of Franklin, which is, you know, median household income is only $22,000 a year. It was Black and brown folks who are living in, you know, who are paying exorbitant rents, who were asking for this project to get built because all it was doing was replacing a gas station. And then we had a bunch of older, whiter, all white, wealthy homeowners on the other side of the street who were complaining about their views and what would happen to their views if this five-story building got built. And it was just so stark and intense. And ultimately, unfortunately, the folks who lived on the north side of Franklin had the resources to bring in attorneys and take the developer to court, and they got the building shortened and reduced the number of affordable units from 16 to 11. And it just, that to me is like, that happens over and over and over and over. But this particular location was just like, to see in 2020, this is a couple of years ago, but to see this playing out, the exact thing that we created with redlining almost a century ago, was pretty stark.
Thank you so much for sharing. It is stark. And I think that I also want to just name what everyone's sharing in the chat, right? So some stories regarding like racially integrated neighborhoods and like, you know, even across the United States, I think that we see parallels with that. But I think that I'm using this word loosely, but like it's most concentrated in LA, the way that like it interacts with, you know, all of these different systems that we have at play. And we actually have another hand raised. Tracy, I'm gonna go ahead and unmute you right now.
Thank you. I think this has always affected me, and I just didn't necessarily know it was affecting me until I took a sociology class in undergrad in Moore Park College, of all places, because I went to Moore Park College because I was getting a better education there. They had better teachers, the class sizes were smaller. And I knew that, and I had a privilege that I definitely wanted to utilize to make sure that my education was something that I wanted it to be, you know, that I had that privilege, that choice to have a car, even a car is a privilege, to drive all the way to Moore Park from the San Fernando Valley to get that. But in this sociology class, they did that. I don't know if you guys have ever done that sociology project where they have you stand at a line and then they read off a bunch of things like, you know, take two steps forward if you've ever been a part of a country club, you know, take two steps back if you've ever experienced poverty in your life, you know, and then, you know, to see the vast differences. I had no idea that none of this was my fault, that it was systemically something that has always been there. And, you know, that it was created by white people and that it was used to manipulate the system to have it be so that mixed people like me, like I had a white mother, but a Filipino father. And it was very interesting growing up in that dynamic because he wasn't there, but my mom was, but people wouldn't think that I was my mom's daughter. And growing up, living in apartment buildings and not being able to find housing, I didn't understand it obviously at the time because I'm a kid, but now as an adult, I'm still having the same issues that my mother had 30 years ago, trying to find an affordable apartment for myself just so I can survive. It's disheartening. And I'm glad that I'm a part of this group I'm also part of San Fernando Valley EMB. I'm representing the team now because everyone else is busy. But I think that it's like even hearing this over and over again, it's just super stark. And having communities around me that I grew up around, you know, Chatsworth, for instance, they were trying to build affordable housing there. And I was in the neighborhood app that everybody goes on next door. And they were posting these signs about how they wanted to not allow it because it was next to a school. You know, they had all of these things to say about it, but I knew that it wasn't about it being down the street from the school. You know, I knew it was because Chatsworth is predominantly white. All you have to do is Google the demographics. And it's just really frustrating. And I'm glad that everybody's here talking about this and that we're here sharing our stories and really, you know, figuring out how to fix this. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Tracy. Just wanted to name that a lot of people are sending you love in the chat. And, you know, thank you for your vulnerability. Like, these are difficult conversations. You know, people think that housing is just this world of real estate developers and, you know, just really like hard lines, and but there's people behind it, like Chase and Rod were saying earlier. It's really affecting lives here. So thank you so much for sharing. Great. Does anybody else have any reflections or anything else that they would like to share?
I just want to say one thing. I just think the whole concept of redlining, I didn't even know about it until like last year. And I just think it's so important, and we need to figure out a way to like teach people these things. You know, it's one of those things that they don't teach you in school that you need to learn about, because it's so important to like understanding so many different things like racism, homelessness, like how they all intersect. And so I'm like Tracy said, like, I'm glad we're all talking about it and learning about it. So thank you for sharing all the information. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for being here. It's the start of it, right? So really appreciate it. So Rod is dropping some really important links in the chat, like some actionable items. And if you want to get involved, and I actually have some more information in the next slide about how we can get involved. But I believe that Suzanne, would you like to say something if you don't mind unmuting yourself?
Hey, everybody. This is bringing up a lot of feelings in me. And I've been a nurse for 100 years. I've been worked in the ER at Cedars Sinai for 25, which was a great experience, because working at Cedars is like working at the United Nations. I've taken care of people from all walks of life, race, creed, color, around the world and everything, moving here from down south in 1990. So I was taking a class towards my degree, and it was about homeless. I chose that because this is a very important subject to me. And it was like 2 years ago when they raised the gas tax and they were gonna use all the money to help the homeless. And I was all excited about it. And when I mentioned it to people, they said, oh, forget that, they'll never do anything. I went to the meeting at the courthouse. There were people from all sorts of organizations, and they were so excited about it. And then nothing really happened, or if it did, it's been really slow. And right now I'm out of town, and my son has been, he's in California, and he's been sending me videos of the increase in homeless tents everywhere. And, you know, he says, what's going on? So my thing is, it's really, I really am glad to hear all the conversations, some of these things I've never thought of. I knew about redlining from a class I took, but I didn't understand the total impact of it. And my husband's in real estate. He's a realtor. And I remember many times hearing him on the phone say, no, you can't do that because you're discriminating. Like maybe if somebody didn't want him to show the place to somebody, and I always admired his sticking to his guns about that. So I just wanted to share that because I think this is a very, very, very important subject. And I do think that we all need to be involved and care about each other, because nothing else is going to work out. We'll just destroy everybody if we don't stick together and listen. People have to listen and understand that other people may have feelings that you never even thought of in a million years because you didn't have to. Thanks.
No, thank you so much, Suzanne. Couldn't have summed it up better, honestly. And I think Chase and Rod are sharing some really great resources in the chat as well regarding his climate plans on the West Side, basically just all about the community plan, how zoning works. And I believe there is an event next week with Climate Resolve. I have it featured here. And then Rod is also talking about the Undesigned the Red Line exhibit, which, and he's also linked the registration link in the chat. And Michael's linked us a really great book. That's a great book. I love that book. And we will send all of this information out in a cohesive email. But right, that brings us to what you can do, right? Action items. So for Safe Place for Youth, and I'll let Rod and Chase take on their parts, right, for their organizations. But with Safe Place for Youth, we have a host homes informational session, and that's gonna be on Wednesday, March 17th at 6 to 7 p.m., which is really important. The host homes program is a really great program that we have where folks that live in the area offer up available space in their homes for SPI members to stay in for 3 to 6 months. So it's going to be an entire informational session on that. And so that's gonna be on that Wednesday. We also have a book club that we're doing. It's Me and White Supremacy, just learning about how that definitely perpetuates itself in every aspect of life. And so we're trying to dig even deeper and, you know, tie it contextually to how this affects SPI members. Another thing you can do is volunteer to help keep track of local neighborhood councils. You hear a lot of this dialogue happening within the neighborhood councils, and there seems to be a little bit of a lack of representation on folks that are pro-housing, or at least starting to learn how to be pro-housing. So if you're interested, please do volunteer with us and, you know, take advantage of that opportunity and join me in listening to that. And of course, you can also sign up for our mailing list, which is where we often will email out actionable items regarding different state bills, assembly bills that we think are going to contribute to increasing more housing and creating more racially equitable frameworks into allowing people to live in different neighborhoods. But yeah, and then there's Climate Resolve and Abundant Housing. I don't know who wants to go first, but yeah, go ahead.
I can go. Thank you so much to everybody that came. I was just blown away with the turnout, and thank you so much for sharing. It's just like really incredibly touching and moving to hear everyone's stories. So really appreciate that. One thing I wanted to say is that all of this is a lot to take. It's very heavy. But we have a huge, huge opportunity to change all of this. We have two different planning processes going on right now. Rod is going to talk about and has been talking about one of them. But the one that I'm talking about is the community plan updates. So we get to draw our own maps. So we get to redesign our communities. And the reality is there aren't a lot of people that participate in this process, right? The threshold for monumental sweeping change is like a couple thousand people in areas that are populated with hundreds of thousands of people. So please get involved. You don't need to be an expert. If you have waited a long time for a bus, you have planning expertise. If you couldn't afford an apartment one time, you have planning expertise. So please, please get involved. We have an event on February the 25th, specifically about the West Side. So if you live on the West Side, come by, bring your friends. Again, the more people we get to turn out for this stuff, it's really as simple as just sharing your thoughts with the city, and we can make really fundamental change. And we have more information about that project at climateplans.la. I'll hand it off to Rod.
Thank you, Chase. Yes, so Annie just came through, always the plug. I was looking for all of this information, but there's like, y'all, there's so much happening over the next month, and it's just really, really beautiful to see everything that's happening. So there's just the keeping the energy going. So Annie just put and plugged the West Side for Everyone group we have going. We're meeting, we're talking, we're keeping these narratives going. There is, of course, like I said, next week, there's our Undesign the Red Line exhibit. That's going to be an entire 2-hour session diving deep, going through the entire timeline of Los Angeles, talking with a variety of people who are going to be able to speak so eloquently to this issue and to talk about what comes next. I just dropped the link to, while they met their goal, I think we can still donate more. There is a redlining, gentrification, and housing in East Hollywood series happening. There's going to be 3 panels. I myself will be speaking on the last panel about where do we go next. And then, of course, there's like just getting involved with your housing element process that's happening in your city. We have a group in Culver City. We have a group in Santa Monica. We have a group on the west side of the city of Los Angeles. We're trying to get a group going in WeHo. So we're getting all of these groups going to do the work in their respective cities. And so we're going to strongly encourage everyone to join. Like, I already dropped the link to my Calendly so you can schedule a meeting, but all of these resources I will make sure y'all get. And then if you want me to, Sahar, I can cover the general actions or you can take it over. Okay. So then general actions wise, we have White People for Black Lives. It's really an amazing space for people to, you know, come together and learn, not just about housing, but more broadly, how to be a white advocate. It's one thing to, it's one thing to just be, you know, helping and talking about these issues. It's another thing to step into advocacy and to do the work diligently. There's the Reimagine LA Housing Subcommittee, or more broadly, there are a lot of committees. There's housing, but there are also a few other subcommittees. If you have the time, we strongly, strongly, strongly encourage you to join those subcommittees. And last but not least, it's actually just as an update because I'm also aware of this. Neighborhood council elections are currently happening and underway. So if you did not apply to run, your best bet is to wait until election season is over. And if there are any empty spots left, to apply to join. Obviously, in the current moment, you can't join, but there are several neighborhood councils on the West Side. I've been to several meetings. And we need people who actually care about this, because a lot of people, I can't state what their intentions are or not. I'm not here to, you know, discuss who they are or what they do. But what I do know is the actions that they take continue to produce and reproduce outcomes that continue to perpetuate segregation, racism, classism, and ultimately Trumpism is what it comes down to. And so if anyone, especially after we just voted out the former president, and we'll be hopefully voting to impeach said former president, if we want to just keep this trend going of getting rid of every stench and piece of Trump in our communities, we have to really stand up and combat this issue. Trump obviously did not create it, but he is a symptom of what can happen if these issues are not dealt with. So that's a lot of information. Like I said, we got a comprehensive email coming for y'all. Brace yourselves. And, you know, again, I just want to say to Chase's point, thank you to everyone who took time out of your Thursday nights. It's been real busy lately. February came in. It just felt like we all hit the ground running. Thank you to Tracy for sharing your story. Thank you to Luke for sharing your story. And again, thank you to everyone.
Yeah, thank you so much, everybody. And we really appreciate you taking the time to listen to our amazing speakers who have such a wealth of knowledge about this is just the beginning. And I hope that everyone just finds a piece to sort of engage more with and like learn more. So thank you so much. We have our emails listed out right here. And we have about 10 minutes left. So, you know, we can stay on for any questions that anyone may have. We have so many amazing resources going in the chat. If anybody would like to ask something to me, to our speakers, please go ahead. And yes, we will also connect everybody to all the resources that are being mentioned here tonight. So thank you.